Alright, so we're back with another flight with the Skyhunter. Nothing really special for this flight. Nothing, you know, planned out of the ordinary or anything like that. Just gonna take off and fly towards town and kind of loop back towards the river and go from there. Now, at this point, I didn't realize it at the time, but when I launched the airplane, I'm assuming that's when it happened. But basically, I had two batteries. I have the two 4S 5200 lipos, and I'm guessing it's when I launched, but at some point during the flight, they slid back out of the Velcro straps that were holding them into the fuselage, and one of them, when I landed, one of them was all the way in the back of the fuselage. One was kind of a little bit behind where it went, but the other one was all the way in the back. So that actually made my center of gravity pretty far back. So you may notice during the flight that airplane seems to get kind of sensitive in the pitch axis. Now right now I'm holding a little bit of climb, not really steep or anything, but you'll notice it once I start leveling things off, it kind of feels like the air's kind of gusty. You see the airplane getting kind of rocked around and not flying real smooth and stable like it usually does. It didn't feel right. And now I knew that on the ground it was dead calm. You can see I'm flying earlier in the morning. I usually do my flights late in the afternoon, but this one was an hour and a half or so after the sunrise. Now I assumed that maybe it was a little bit windy up high, but I wasn't really seeing that looking at my airspeed compared to my GPS. I checked it a couple of times. There was a little bit of wind, a little bit of difference in the two, but not really enough. And you see that kind of fog off on the horizon lifting, that kind of moisture in the air is kind of burning off and lifting in the air. That wasn't really getting stirred around and blown around very much. It, you know, everything pointed to the airplane should have been flying smoother than it was. And like I said, I didn't realize it at the time, but it was those batteries slid back and shifted the CG back. So the Vector was doing a pretty good job of countering that and kind of masking it. And Skyhunter is pretty tolerant, has a pretty wide range of center of gravity that it will fly in, but obviously it doesn't fly as good with the CG as far back as it was here. But so that's what was up. No other than that, it's just a routine flight. Like I said, I had the two 4S 5200s on board, and you see right now I'm just kind of setting my failsafe, putting return to home, and set the failsafe in that condition. So should I lose signal, it'll go back to that. But anyway, getting back to the gear on board, I'm flying a Skyhunter with the two 4S 5200 lipos. Still have the Foxeer toothless FPV camera, which you can see in the top corner of the video frame there. The analog feed and the HD video is being recorded with the GoPro Hero 4 Black, as usual. And for the radio, I'm flying with the Radio Master TX-16S using the Dragonlink V3. And everything else is pretty much standard. You can see here I'm just kind of flying around looking down into the woods, a little feeding plot where they hunt. I think there's a little feeder right out in the middle of that clearing next to the one tree that they did leave. And there's probably a deer stand tucked away around the perimeter of it somewhere in the woods. Kind of notice when I look over the wing off to the side like that, you can see it, and on the AHI you can see it too. The airplane's kind of pitching up and down, and right now I'm cruising at about 8 to 8.5 amps, right around there is where I have my throttle set. And normally that's pretty normal. I'll usually fly around 6.5 or 7 or so if I'm trying to conserve energy on a single battery. I usually like to run around 8.5 or so when I'm carrying two batteries like it was today. But I kind of noticed that little buffeting and pitching going on, and actually later in the flight you'll see I bumped the cruise amps up closer to 9.5 to 10 or so. Just thinking it might help out carrying both batteries, and maybe that's what was going on. But and you see it wasn't really bad at this point. It will get worse later in the flight. But I'm guessing that maybe the battery's been kind of migrated around in the fuselage over the duration of the flight, but I don't know. You'll see it coming up though, it kind of gets worse. And I even looked over the tail a few times, panning the camera back, just to make sure that there wasn't something coming loose on the tail or something. I knew something wasn't right. I just didn't realize what it was. I'm just here right now. I decided not to fly over town. Just stayed north of town, following the perimeter there. Point, I don't remember exactly when it was, but somewhere right around this time I started getting the trainer signal recover, trainer signal lost alerts on the TX-16S, and that happens when the Dragon Link is pumping out full power with it too close to the transmitter, like I showed in some of the videos where I was talked about the 433 megahertz interference. Both the jumper T-16 and the Radio Master TX-16S, they both do it, even with shielding in the back cover, but they only do it when the Dragon Link is pushing out high power and close to the transmitter. So you can see now at this point I've turned back to home, and you'll see I'm going to switch into return to home and let the autopilot fly the airplane. And if you watch, my RSSI is currently normal signal level. You'll watch when I switch the radio off now, you can see it's dropped all the way to zero. And what I'm doing at this point, I've turned the radio off, and I'm going to remove the Dragon Link antenna, and I'm going to switch it out with this little cable here. As you can see, the cable runs up behind the monitors and up the wall and follows up to this little magnetic mount that I have on the wall with another 433 megahertz antenna. So I've switched over to that one, and I'm going to power the radio back up, and you'll see my RSSI come back once I do that. And that basically just moves the antenna up into a better position, and it's not down on my desk behind the monitors where I'm flying from. It moves it up higher on the wall, a little bit higher up, and not shielded by those monitors. And it also moves the antenna further away from the transmitter, so where it's radiating, the RF power is not right on the back of the radio. So that not only gives it a better signal, but it helps the issue with the radio. And I mentioned the better signal, because what's going on there is the Dragon Link is the transmitter module is set to auto power, so it only pushes out enough RF energy to maintain a decent RSSI signal. That's why my RSSI is never really full power, you know, full 99 whatever percent, 100% RSSI, because it only pushes out enough RSS power or RF power to keep the RSSI in a moderate range. And usually the high 60s, low 70s is pretty much about where it stays. But in order to do that, you have to use a two-way communication between the transmitter and the receiver. So the receiver is sending telemetry back to the transmitter, and that's how the transmitter knows what the RSSI signal level is at the receiver. Now, I can see my RSSI on the OSSD even once the radio drops telemetry. Your telemetry doesn't have as much range as your control signal from the radio up to the airplane. Your downlink from the airplane back to the radio isn't as strong. So what happens is when you start losing that telemetry signal, the transmitter just bumps the power up to full. Just, you know, better safe than sorry. It just assumes the worst and just bumps the power up to full, because it doesn't know how to regulate the, know what it needs to do to regulate the power anyway, because it doesn't know what the signal level is at the airplane, so it just pushes full power. And like I said, I can still see the RSSI on the OSD, but the transmitter doesn't get the telemetry signal back to know what that RSSI level is. So by moving the antenna up on the wall, it also, not only does it get the RF energy away from my transmitter, but it also allows it to pick up the telemetry from the airplane a little bit easier. That's what I was kind of getting to before I started rambling on too much. So anyway, we've done that, and now I'm headed back towards the direction where I was at. I'm gonna go fly out towards the river and turn north and follow the river north. Now, at this point, like I said, you can see the airplane is kind of buffing it around quite a bit. It almost feels like I'm flying in really gusty wind, but I know that's not the case. It's dead calm on the ground. The weather reports are all showing no wind this morning. That's why I really wanted to get a flight in today. you know, earlier in the day. But the airplane sure does feel like it's really gusty. And I just, you know, it was a CG issue, but I just didn't realize it at the time. So that's kind of one reason I decided to stay away from towns. I wasn't 100% sure what was wrong with the airplane. I knew something wasn't right. I just thought maybe it was kind of, you know, the sun was kind of breaking. I thought maybe it was ground heating starting to get turbulent during the day, which normally does happen earlier in the morning, especially on a clear sunny day. But you can see there was a lot of moisture still in the air and wasn't really a lot of direct sunlight. So I kind of thought we might have a couple of hours of more calm air before everything started getting rough, kind of in the midday. So I just, to play it safe, I decided to stay away from town, and then I didn't fly out over the river. I didn't cross the river. I just kind of followed it over on this side. So that in kind of a worst case scenario, if the airplane did happen to go down or something, then it would at least increase my odds of finding it. Wouldn't, you know, of course it's never guaranteed, but I thought it would give me a better chance of finding it if it was in the woods or the fields on this side of the river. It'd be easier to go out and search for it. But if I really thought I was going to lose the airplane, I would have headed straight back home over the open fields. You know, I didn't really think I was going to lose it, but I don't know, just kind of, it's a good idea to play it more safe than sorry. But so anyway, you can see we're following the river now and see just how much current is in that water out in the river. The water looks really turbulent. I guess there's a lot of water flowing down the river right now. Water level is kind of high, not like super high or anything, but it's a little bit higher than normal. And the higher the water is, the faster the current. So that's what's going on. That's what's, you know, what's up with that rough surface on the water there. And you can see just over the river there, those low hanging clouds right out in that direction there. They look easily reachable. And you can see I'm actually flying at 400 feet right now, and those clouds don't look much higher, if any higher at all. And now I'm calling them clouds. It's really just moisture burning off in the morning, kind of fog. It wasn't really foggy that morning. It's just so much humidity in the air down here right now. It's so moist and everything. It's just kind of, every morning we kind of get that moisture that will burn off, make these little clouds early in the morning, and they clear up pretty quick. But like I said, I considered going across the river and fly around by those a little bit, but I didn't really want to chance it not knowing what was up with the airplane. So like I said, you can see it's really kind of buffeting around a lot in the pitch axis right now. I mean, it's holding altitude pretty good, and that's really what's going on here. The airplane's flying a little bit tail heavy. It's not so much to the point that it's unstable, but it's definitely out of trim in the pitch axis, and that's what's going on. The OSD is kind of fighting what it thinks should be center trim and maintaining altitude and trying to hold airplane level. It's just kind of getting in this oscillation, and you'll see that later once I go to land, when I switch out of altitude and just go into a standard normal 2D stabilization. You'll see that everything smooths out quite a bit, and you see there's one point where I looked back over the tail trying to figure out. I was kind of watching back there to make sure the tail wasn't buffeting, the tail booms hadn't come loose, or maybe a servo linkage was coming off, or just something crazy like that. You know, just kind of checking it out. I knew something wasn't right at this point. You know, I was pretty sure of it. So what I did, I kind of stayed out over this open field for a minute. I'll follow the river back towards the other end of that field, and I made a turn and flew out over the trees towards home. See, my airspeed, which is in the little ladder on the center left side of the OSD, is currently sitting around 39-40 miles per hour, and the ground speed is in the lower left corner right below it. See, the ground speed is currently sitting on 43. That's my GPS, 42-43. So there's a little bit of wind, but not much, just a few miles an hour at the most. And it seems like we have a tailwind right now. We've picked up, we're out four or five miles an hour higher on the ground speed than you are with the airspeed. But you'll see once I turn back towards home in a minute, that actually drops, and it looks like I have a bit of a headwind. So we'll lose a little bit of altitude and see if it really was windy or what. So when I was kind of starting to second guess the wind thing and thinking maybe there was some wind up here at altitude, but I don't think that was the case. Yeah, you can see now I'm starting to make my turn back towards home. Back west towards home now, and you can see now my airspeed is still right around 39-40 miles per hour, and my ground speed has dropped to 31 miles per hour. So at this point I do have a little bit of a headwind, and I was thinking that maybe that's what's going on, maybe that's what I'm feeling with the airplane. So I kind of kept this altitude for a ways. I'm still right at 4 miles, 3.7, I think it's a little bit closer to 4. Out closer to the river before we made the turn, but I'm also almost 4 miles out from home, so I didn't want to drop too low just yet. Although if we did, it would just go ahead and fail safe and climb back up. I think my fail safe is set for 500 feet, which is enough, and I have it set at that. Normally, I would try to keep it at 400 feet to stay legal, but I do have it. My fail safe is set to 500, because there is a radio tower out in town that I usually fly around on the other side of it and everything, and it is 420 feet above ground level. So I have my return to home set to 500 just to avoid the tower and the support cables for it. And also, usually if I lose signal, it's probably going to be because I flew too low, and once the return to home climbs back up to altitude, I'll regain my signal, hopefully, and we'll fly the airplane again. You can see now I've actually cut the power back a little bit, and I've pushed the nose down. I'm going to start losing altitude. If I remember right, I think I went down to about 200 or 220 or something like that. I think I stopped at 220 over the trees for a ways. You can see we leveled off here about 215 to 220 or so, and push the cruise power back up to about 9.5 amps, 9 to 9.5 or so. Now you can see I'm still flying at the same 37-38 miles an hour. So I am cruising a little bit less amps than I was, closer to 10 before. So we're sitting around 38 to 39 miles an hour airspeed, and now we're up to 42. But my ground speed has come up a little bit. We still have some headwind, but we were cruising at about 31 miles an hour. And we've actually dropped a little bit on the cruise power, and we picked up the speed. It was closer to 35. Now it's dropped to 31. So it's kind of varying a little bit as I'm kind of pointing this all out. We're actually down to 29 now. But it seemed to help a little bit flying down low, but the airplane was still kind of buffeting around. So at that point, I was pretty sure it wasn't the wind. It really shouldn't have been. But like I said, I wasn't 100% sure what the issue was until I landed and I pulled the hatch off and I saw the batteries had migrated to the back of the fuselage. So it's probably a good thing I didn't venture out too far or stay in the air too long. But like I said, I was carrying the two 4S5200s. I was intending to fly further, longer than I was. But I'm pretty sure, I don't remember exactly how much, but you see we're sitting at like 3,200 milliamp hours used right now. And we have, what was that, 10,400 total. I wouldn't have really pushed it more than about 10,000. But I pretty sure I could have flew about twice as long as I did. Still had plenty of reserve left in the batteries. But you can see just how much the airplane is getting rocked around. Sure feels like a windy, gusty day, but it just wasn't. And you see again, there's some of those low low-hanging clouds. They're a little bit above me now. I'm flying at like 200 feet now. They're actually a little bit lower than that. But, I decided to go ahead and just make a shoot back for home and get it down and figure out what the problem was. So I'm just kind of checking out some of the tree lines, fuels and things like that along the way. See some more of those low clouds right up ahead right there. We're actually passing under some. You can see they're a little bit easier on the OSD overlay there. You can see them in the top right corner of it. So they were in the HD video too. The OSD is covering that up. But they're really close. They were easy to get above them and play around a little bit. Which, they were some real light faint clouds anyway, not special. Not often you get to do some cloud surfing at 400 feet or less. Looking over the tail again, just kind of looking to make sure it's not back there flapping around or something, which it wasn't. Everything was fine, just other than those batteries. And just quick note on that, the reason they slid back like that, I usually use the silicon coated, like the little rubbery grippy battery straps, and I have Velcro in the bottom of the fuselage, and I'll usually wrap the straps around the battery and then stick them down to the Velcro. But the ones I used today were just some straight nylon without the grip layer coating in them. And that's probably why they slid. So I'll just have to make a mental note of that to not use those anymore. But as you can see now, like I said, I'm flying in 2D mode right now. And when I center the stick, you can see it keeps pitching up. The airplane, I'm actually having to hold the nose down. So it's way out of trim. But you can see we're going to do a quick landing now. Ultralight waiting to be worked on. That's going to be a few months out. I'm on the waiting list for the new sales, and it's kind of the only thing I'm waiting on. I got everything else ready for it. And while we check out these birds circling around, I guess they saw the airplane land, came to see what was up. I'll go ahead and take a note to thank you for watching the video, and especially for sticking around all the way to the end, and a big thank you to the patrons who make this all happen. And I'll have links to relevant stuff that are used for the video below. Check those out. They are affiliate links. I'll get a kickback if you use those. And if you do, I appreciate it. If not, I still appreciate you watching the video. So keep an eye out for what's to come.